Hello, everybody. Thank you, Emmanuel, for the introduction. And thank you, Ludovic, for having accepted to make this conference. Ludovic is a gemmorphologist. He's a senior lecturer at the laboratory Editem at the University of Savoie Mont Blanc in Chambéry, in France. Ludovic Ravanel is a mountaineer, and maybe worth to note that this patronym is quite famous in the Chamonix area, since many mountain guides bear this name for several decades. The research of Ludovic focuses on the dynamics of glacial and periglacial landscapes in high mountains areas, and in particular on the evolution of steep rock walls located in permafrost areas. Ludovic has been working in the Mont Blanc Massif for the last 15 years now, and has documented hundreds of rock falls events associated with permafrost degradation. And his conference will precisely focus on this aspect of the impact of climate change on rock wall permafrost. So Ludovic, I give you the floor for the next 40 to 45 minutes maximum. After what we will have around 15 minutes for questions. So you can write your question in the chat. And I will try to pick the most interesting ones for the question session, or you can ask also your question directly after the conference. So thank you, Ludovic.
Merci, Christophe. Merci, Emmanuel. Bonsoir à tous. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the invitation for this very nice week dedicated to geomorphology. I would also like to thank the Interdisciplinary Center for Mountain Research at the University of Lausanne for hosting me for a few months and inviting me to present this research. This evening, I will try to make an overview, not exhaustive, of course, of the work we have done for the last 15 years in the Mont Blanc Massif. It is the result of a whole team, but only a dozen names appear here. Sorry for the others, but I think about them. So we will start with a first observation. This is an up-to-date subject with destabilization that may have mobilized huge volumes. For example, this one a few weeks ago, as you probably know, there was a major disaster of glacial or periglacial origin in the northern India. From the slope of the Trizul Peak, located at an altitude of over 7,000 meters, 25 million cubic meters of rock and ice fell down 2,000 meter slope before producing a gigantic debris flow that traveled down over tenths of kilometers. More than 200 persons.
Ludovic, we just make it full screen.
Ça devrait aller, non?
Voilà.
Bon.
Parfait, merci.
Comment perdre du temps? So, we come back to the Trizul Peak. We have unfortunately more than 200 persons that have probably been killed. Here is the situation before the event, and this is the situation after the event. You can see the traces of the dust cloud all along the valley. And a little closer, here is the situation of the rock face before and after. And you can see that the top part of the scar is particularly straight. If we go back in the history, already in 2017, a large fracture was visible that you can see here and here in the recent period. And this phenomenon affected an entire hanging glacier and a considerable thickness of the underlying rock that detached, explaining the dust cloud. Another event had already affected the area 5 years ago and created a debris flow, but not as the last one. The scar is completely gigantic, more than 500 meters wide, and the depth of the detachment that you can see on this peak is quite exceptional. 6,000 further west, kilometers further west, the Alpine Star is the Piz-Cengalo, already affected by a rock avalanche of more than 1 million cubic meters in 2011. More than 3 million cubic meters of rock have fallen from the north face at the end of the 2017 heat wave, causing the melting of a small cirque glacier and a large debris flow traveled down on 6 kilometers, destroying a part of the Bondo village. Here we see the consequences of the event. Fortunately, it did not happen in the valley to the west, which you can see here, where there is a dam lake. It could have been worse and worse. The rock avalanche in 2017 is the largest high altitude avalanche in the Alps since 1717. We leave the northern hemisphere to go on the other one. Here is a very important event that affected one of the peaks near the Mont Cook. The Mont Cook is the highest point in New Zealand. And in that case, between 4 and 5 million cubic meters of rock have traveled down on 4 kilometers, spared a refuge, which is in the red circle. And again, this is one of the biggest events of the last decades. Second observation, there are also many intermediate volume rockfalls, as here in the Mont Blanc Massif. We have here the Trident in September 2018. And this event really shocked the mountaineers who saw collapsing this mountain thought to be extremely solid. The comparison between photogrammetric and LiDAR models showed a volume of 42,000 cubic meters of granite. This is the comparison between the two. And this is a peak that have been taken from helicopter just after the event. And you can clearly see that a large amount of ice is present into the scar. We will be back on this ice very soon because this one is very, very interesting. Another mid-volume event is this one, still on the French side of the Mont Blanc Massif. This is a rockfall that affected one of the largest avalanche couloir in Europe. This is the Tacona couloir. You can see the defense infrastructure here, down into the valley. And in that case, a little bit less than 43,000 cubic meters of gneiss collapsed in the valley. This event is quite interesting because it occurred at quite low elevation. And there is an important travel of nearly 2 kilometers due to the presence of the Tacona Glacier that you can see here and the steep slope. And finally, the front of the avalanche finished at 1,500 meters in elevation. This is the front of the avalanche, which has incorporated a significant volume of ice. This avalanche stopped not so far from the construction site of an hydroelectric power plant. This is a reminder about the fact that the risk associated with rockfalls can include the valleys. Third observation, we are here not so far from the Aiguille du Midi, and you can see a little volume. The third observation is the fact that small collapses have been extremely numerous in the recent years. By small volume, we mean a few hundreds or a few thousand cubic meters of rock. And here it affected a ridge which is very, very frequented by mountaineers. It's very close to the cable car. And on that day, there were people before and after the event, but fortunately not during the event. So here we have not so far from 3,000 cubic meters of rock that have collapsed, and many pictures have been took because many alpinists were in that this area. About little volumes, we can think about the heat wave of 2003. These small rockfalls have been very frequent during this summer. You remember the heat wave we had, and this heat wave provoked a real awareness of mountaineers and researchers. Remember in particular the closure of one of the Matterhorn routes and the evacuation by helicopter of nearly 70 climbers. So it was fantastic for the medias and for many weeks. It was quite the same in 2015. Jacques Mouret spoke to you yesterday about the case of the accidental couloir of the Goutet, giving access to the summit of the Mont Blanc. And despite all those examples, which are quite numerous, proof had to be provided of an increase in the frequency and volume of the rockfalls. In other words, is there a real increase or is it an observation basis? Maybe we are more careful about that during the last years, or maybe it's a real evolution about this high mountain area. So for this, I will be back on a former research about one of the most famous rock face of the Alps. This is the Druwelf West face. And in that face, a little avalanche changed the face in 2005 with a collapse of all the very famous Bonatti Pillar, which were climbed for the first time 50 years before the event. This is the rock face before and after the event. So on the right, you can see that a large gray square of 700 meter high is now scratching the face. And by looking at the situation before, we can already see a scare. So the question we can have is, do we have other rockfall in the past? So we had to reconstruct this evolution, the evolution of the rock face. To do so, we needed a large amount of data to answer this question. We had collected and compared hundreds of pictures since the end of the Little Ice Age. We had the chance to have a good picture from the beginning of the history of the photography in high mountain areas, and it is recorded to the end of the Little Ice Age. And in this area, a dozen events have been highlighted between 1905 and 2005, or even 2011, which is the last most important event. So the event is here. So it has enlarged the upper part of the scale. And here we note an acceleration of the morphodynamics in terms of frequency, but also in terms of volume with the collapse of 2005. As we cannot be satisfied with just one rock face, we did the same work on the whole northern side of the Aiguille de Chamonix. And in that case, nearly 80 events have been recorded, like here in the west face of the Aiguille de Blétière. And they are mostly concentrated during the 40s. You can see the stick here, and during the two last decades. So this is a quite ancient work. So it needs to be completed. And unfortunately, there is no stick for this decade, but it would come clearly out of the slide because the last decade was very, very active. A work on a regional scale had shown the same pattern. It means a first great stick in the 40s, and finally two very impressive sticks during the last decades. So we have a highly variable rockfall frequency. First, the stability was quite high, and finally, during the two last decades, a large amount of rockfall have been recorded in those two rock faces. Now we know the link between the climate and the rockfalls, and we have to know more about the link between the warming and the rockfall. So we know when the rockfalls are occurring. Now we have to verify the link with the climate. So this is the mean annual temperature in Chamonix. The second one is the mean summer temperature. And you have finally the same figure as before. And you can see the great correlation between the two. So finally, the thermal parameters appear very fundamental. And now, remains to go beyond the last century and a half, because of course with this method we only use photo, and as I said, photo are dating back to the end of the Little Ice Age. So to go further in the history, we carried out 80 cosmogenic datings with beryllium 10 on nine rock walls of the Mer de Glace feeding basin. 80, it's a lot, but it is also a little. However, we already note quite good correlation between the rock falls and the hottest period of the Holocene. And of course, we would need more dates, but beryllium is expensive. And finally, we had to find another method to know more about the rockfall based on the color. The idea was the redder the granite, the older it seems to be exposed. You have here this sketch. First, you have a former rock face. And during the history of the face, some piece of rock collapsed. And finally, the upper one is the most older exposed part of the rock face. It's not the red on which we worked. Finally, we developed something like a composite index between the green and the red. This is the Grigri index, and this index gives very consistent results with beryllium. This is here what you have. The cubic error is very good. And similarly, we obtain a good relationship between measured age and the predicted age. So now the method must be implemented in the Mont Blanc Massif, because we only have the method, and now we have to use this method. The second objective of our research was to verifying that permafrost degradation is clearly the link between global warming and rockfalls. So you probably know that this hypothesis is the one of the team of Wilfried Eiberli at the University of Zurich. It was in the 70s. But before going further on, tonight we may have not only a specialist in permafrost, so we will define it. Permafrost is concerning any lithospheric material whose temperature is permanently below or at 0 degree. Permafrost is a thermal state. It's not visible, but there are a few evidences. For example, rock glaciers, as this one. There was a presentation about that on Monday. And in the rock faces, there are hanging glaciers, which are a glacier with a negative temperature. It is quite difficult to predict where there is permafrost or where there is no. It depends on various factors, including topography. And in any case, there is, as you can see here on the sketch, an active layer that shows each year. And the permafrost, due to its thermal state, allows the presence of ice into the discontinuities of the rock. So this is a picture of the Mont Blanc Massif. There is a line between permafrost and no permafrost, but of course, it's much more complicated due to all the parameters that are getting advantage in the permafrost degradation. Well, this presence of ice is attested by different observer, and we can link the ice with collapse with many processes. There was a presentation from Michael Krautblätter on Monday about that, but we can cite reduction of shear and tensile strength, reduction in friction along the fracture, loss of rock ice adhesion, and so on to explain the rock falls. In former laboratory work, drastic changes in the tensile strength or safety factors were already observed around 0 degree here, or not so far from 0 degree. We note that the safety factor here is getting very low at minus 2 degrees. In order to verify the role of the permafrost, we set up a network of observers in the years 2005 or something like that, on two-thirds of the Mont Blanc Massif, consisting of guides, hut keepers, mountaineers. We have written papers, we have carried out training courses in order to involve as many people as possible. Every fall, major fieldwork is carrying out to verify and complete the data, and all those data are processed under a GIS. Apps have been developed to facilitate the work of the network, but the most effective method remains direct contact with the observer. Here are a few years of data. We currently have a catalog of approximately 1,500 events, with volume over 100 cubic meters. I'm going to give you a few results. First of all, concerning the thermal condition of the rock, as permafrost is invisible, we need to measure the temperature. It is the upper right picture. And as we cannot measure everywhere, we have to model it. And with such a model, we observe that the majority of the rockfalls occur in context of permafrost, here between 0 and minus 4. Here we have the data of 2005 obtained by remote sensing and the data of 2015 obtained by the network. And we can see that the rockfall don't follow the distribution of the rockfall. For example, here there are many rockfall but not rockfalls, which is a good news for our hypothesis. And the mid-annual surface temperature looks slightly negative on rockfall location, mainly between -1 and -3. Yesterday, Florence Magnien presented an in-depth look at this work consisting in modeling the temperature at the depths of the collapses for more than 200 events precisely dated. And it is observed that small collapse occur at positive temperature, while for detachment which are greater to 4 to 6 meters, the temperature is around 0 degree or slightly below. And we also have shown that the exceptional temperature, both at the surface and in depth, are an obvious triggering factor. The role of the permafrost is also supported by other evidence. Rockfalls are particularly affecting an altitudinal belt, which is corresponding to the warm permafrost between 3,300 meters and 3,600. The hotter the summer, the higher the rockfall are occurring in altitude. And this is valid for the mean as well as the maximum altitudes, with rockfall sometimes occurring well above 4,000 meters in elevation. Another element, water or ice, is usually visible in the sphere. This was the case in 2005 when the Bonatti pillar collapsed in the west face of the Dru. It was also the case in 2011. And a presentation on Monday also reported ice in a fairly low altitude sphere, around 2,600, if I remember well. We are very interested in this ice because it can provide information about its age, for example. In the sphere, from the rockfall of the Aiguille du Midi in 2017, we went to get some ice despite rather bad safety condition, you can imagine. I'll talk about this later. Another element is the fact that the affected areas are often those where the permafrost is the most sensitive. It means spurs, pillar, edge, ridge. So you can see a paper of Janet Nutley about that. On the left, it was a pillar. On the right, this is a summit in the ridge of the Aiguille de Chamonix. What can we expect for the future? As many natural phenomena, rockfall follow a power law. You can have a look at the work of Dussauge on this subject. And you can see that our data doesn't clearly, precisely follow the power law for small events, which are here, but also for the largest one. For the small ones, it is certainly due to an observation bias. We do not manage to document all the small volumes. For example, here, if the rockfall is occurring very high on the rock face, it gives only few rocks at the end down on the glacier. As for the big ones, we don't miss them, but they are only just beginning to occur. We can therefore expect an increase in large workforce in the coming years and in the coming decades. In addition, we note that the component B, which is this one, is very high in high mountain, which perhaps reflects the role of the permafrost, which tends to delay the largest rockfall over time. So it's probably a sign of the permafrost. We stop here with the data from the network of observer, and let's have a look at the high resolution allowed by LIDAR carried out on a dozen of rock walls. We will be particularly interested in this face of the Tour Ronde, a face that was largely covered with ice a century and a half ago. A very large volume of data is now available, and the face appears particularly unstable. This is a picture of the recent years, and unfortunately, there is a route, a normal route, which is in this area. Here is the comparison over 5 years. You can see the geomorphic activity with volume up to more than 5,000 cubic meters. There is really impressive activity in this rock face. It shows a very high erosion rates that can be connected to the permafrost, but also to the disappearance of the ice apron that was covering the area a few decades ago. For those who are interested, I will give a presentation about ice apron next Monday as part of the seminars of the University of Lausanne. Perhaps, Christophe, you can put the link into the discussion. So extremely high erosion rate and a link which can be done with the ice apron retreat. LIDAR data also makes it possible to anticipate destabilization. Here, for example, two-thirds of a pillar can be seen as tilting. The pillar actually collapsed a little later, revealing ice into the sphere. This ice has been sampled and dated using a particulate organic carbon method. The difficulty is to extract the carbon present in very small quantities, but the method is quite robust. This is the first picture I get from this event. And here are the location of the three samples we had. The two lower one are really consistent. The ice has the same age. And in the upper part of the sphere, the ice is much more recent. That was detected, what we have seen about the pillar that is tilting can also be seen with kinematics data measuring the fracture opening. At the Aiguille du Midi, for example, which for us is a real laboratory, shifts are observed. For example, you have here a pattern which is quite the same during 3 years. And in 2015, as the active layer was much more important than the previous year, there is a shift into the data. So we can imagine that finally a rockfall is the sum up of all an history of little movement like this one. To be back into the ice, we have also a date at the Trident du Tacul, where the ice has been sampled in very hard safety condition. We have an ice which is around 1,500 years old. Another example of the ice, we are here at the Aiguille du Midi in 2017, and the ice is around 4,000 years old in the center of the sphere. It's younger on the sides of the sphere. So finally, the ice, which is cementing our mountains, is therefore generally very, very old. I won't conclude too long. I'm quite in time. I just want to emphasize our work that is intended to help prevention. In this document written for the mountaineers, for example, we have highlighted all the precursory signs of destabilization. It's written in French, but maybe I have to translate this one into English. So it is now prudent when one frequents the mountains to be very attentive to the signals given by the environment. I really want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ludovic. And thank you for keeping the time.